The world's most wanted terrorist plays with the remote in a Pakistan hideout. It's Osama bin Laden, his TV programmed to the Arab news network, Al-Jazeera. The other end of the world, CIA headquarters, an analyst's office. This photo, published in Time magazine, shows the TV tuned to Al Jazeera.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Those who seek influence in the Middle East pay attention to Al Jazeera. Feared by the regimes of the region, trusted by over 60 million viewers, Al Jazeera is a broadcaster too powerful to be ignored. Opinion and opposing opinion, its slogan, politics and polemics, its program. An explosive mixture in a region ripe on unrest. Many believe it was here that the Arab uprising was born. This is the behind-the-scenes story of Al Jazeera, filmed in its studios and its editorial conferences, with the players who write the scripts, with the producers who develop the strategies. This is the inside story from the newsroom where history is being written.
Our station is unique in that it's so much near to the heart of the people in the Arab world, and it's involved in their feelings.
Al Jazeera is the voice of the voiceless. Al Jazeera is a television station that is always present when news is being made. Al Jazeera presents the news, but it doesn't make the news. Al Jazeera shows the whole world what the people in the Middle East are thinking. Al Jazeera, translated the peninsula, is headquartered in Qatar, a small but extremely wealthy country on the coastline of the Arabian Gulf. It is financed by Qatar's emir, basically a government-owned broadcaster. Al Jazeera's editorial line was independent from day one and controversial. In the early years, they were the first to broadcast the taped statement from Osama bin Laden and first to travel with insurgents fighting U.S. forces in Iraq. But Al Jazeera was also the first Arab broadcaster to open a bureau in Israel and to propagate the struggle for women's rights in Arab media. It was here where the international coverage of the Arab uprising began. A spark igniting a bonfire that was to consume the entire Arab world. It began in Tunisia. 17th of December 2010, a small town southwest of Tunis. Mohamed Bouazizi, a young vegetable merchant, is on his way to the market. A policewoman helps herself to his wares without paying. Bouazizi protests and gets slapped. His vegetable cart is confiscated. That night, the humiliated young Tunisian douses himself with gasoline and sets himself afire. Protests break out. Tear gas is fired, people are injured. Yet, the more violent the police, the angrier the demonstrators. With a stone in one hand and a cell phone in the other, they march through the streets. The government closes the city to journalists. But Tunisia has 3.5 million internet users, nearly a third of the population, and news of the protests spreads quickly. On Al Jazeera, it is broadcast to an audience of millions.
Al Jazeera made the Arab people feel that what they are doing is legitimate. They can do that. It's their right to be on the street peacefully telling their governments what they want.
Events in Tunisia change the way news is handled by Al Jazeera. For example, at the satellite desk, where Ali Al-Kabi works. It's his job to coordinate satellites and studios around the world. His job to stay in contact with correspondents. Ali knows how media affect political events.
In the old days that the revolutions may succeed or fail because nobody around will know about them. But for this era, for the Facebook, the Twitter, the satellite channels, the internet, everything. Now, if you feel that the people or the world can see you, then you will have more confidence to do.
As a native of Qatar, Ali Al-Kabi is the exception at Al Jazeera. Staff journalists come from a colorful mixture of Arab countries. Syrians and Sudanese, Egyptians and Algerians, Moroccans and Mauritanians. They share a common language, Arabic, but differ in culture, roots, and political opinions.
20 seconds left. Stand by. Less than seconds. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
The country of Qatar is home to Al Jazeera, a thin peninsula on the Arabian Gulf, a small piece of land, surrounded by long coastlines and rich deposits of oil and natural gas. The Qataris are rich, with the highest per capita income in the world. Qatar is also rich on contradiction. Between the adobe ruins of former civilizations and the glittering skylines twinkling against desert skies, the Qataris live their lives somewhere between the tribal traditions of the Bedouins and the billion-dollar deals of the world's financial markets. They are a people caught between extremes, much like their satellite news network. A slap from a corrupt cop, nothing uncommon in the Arab world. But this time, in Tunisia, it sets off a storm of outrage that rages through the entire Middle East. For Al Jazeera, a game changer. The young vegetable merchant Bouazizi doesn't live to see what he started. In a Tunisian hospital, he succumbs to his burns. Within days of his death, the growing protest leads to the downfall of the country's undemocratic government. On January 14th, 2011, President Ben Ali resigns. The first regime in the Arab uprising has fallen. Before the Tunisian protests, Ali Al-Kabi knows nothing of an Arab Spring. It is autumn 2010, and he is preparing his budget for the coming year. Ali calculates with a 20% surplus for unforeseen events, perhaps a war, maybe a catastrophe. But 2011 brings more. The uprisings in Tunisia, Egypt, Syria, Libya, Yemen, and Bahrain, and Japan with earthquake, tsunami, and a nuclear catastrophe. Scheduled programming is canceled. Al Jazeera is broadcasting breaking news around the clock. And Arab audiences are watching. Ratings explode. An expensive year begins. Coverage is needed everywhere. Costs overrun budgets by multiples. In Qatar, money is not the main problem. It's people who bear the increased burdens. For Ali, this means longer hours, more tension, and a relentless workload. Less time for his wife and four children. The man at the wheel is legend, one of the founding fathers of the satellite news network.
Bye-bye. Yeah, my name is Jamal Ryan. I'm a news anchor in Al Jazeera channel. As you see, I communicate with all the world.
Jamal Rayan knows the history of the satellite station. He sat in their studios 5 months before they launched, practicing pilot programs. When Al Jazeera first went on air on the 1st of November 1996, it was Jamal who reads the first bulletin. Ever since, millions of viewers throughout the Arab world associate his face with Al Jazeera.
When I present my news bulletin, the main news bulletin, at 11 o'clock Doha time, about 60 million estimation people are watching, you know. And this is a big indicating, the indication that in the Arab world, we are leading. We are leading very good.
Jamal Rayan is not just a talking head. During the pioneer years, he made major contributions to policy. For example, the now famous slogan, opinion and opposing opinion, Al Jazeera's motto for controversial programming.
We're totally unacceptable.
Only America!
He has lost the legitimacy.
In the early years, Al Jazeera sought out controversy. Conflict was popular. Polemics were commonplace. And talk shows often turned into shouting matches. It was a time when the new network was breaking many taboos, and the language it chose angered many in the West. Suicide bombers who murdered innocent civilians were labeled martyrs. Today, their editors say, that could never happen.
Every single word in a script that is put on the air is weighed very carefully sometimes, because some of these words may have, you know, political undertones or can be very sensitive or sometimes can be inflammatory. So scripts are strictly monitored here to ensure that we are not being we are not encouraging people or discouraging people.
Jamal is Palestinian, like many editors in key positions at Al Jazeera. He is no friend of Israel. But the network that Jamal helped establish was making history in the Arab world. No one before had ever interviewed an Israeli minister or sent a correspondent to Tel Aviv. These were historical moments for Arab media. Al Jazeera was also groundbreaking in introducing female anchors, not as decoration, but as outspoken journalists in interviews with statesmen. These were the pioneer years, Zero Hour, a network in the making. At the time, other news in the region was pure propaganda. Like this Saudi news show, proclamations from the royal family, with emphasis on protocol and patriotism. There was simply no mention of opposition. In the early years, Jamal Rayan was not convinced Al Jazeera could be different. At the time, there were no independent Arab media. Free press was harassed, censored, or totally prohibited. There was an unwritten law that media never criticized neighboring countries. In the Arab world, the press was more of a lapdog than a watchdog. With Al Jazeera came the age of satellite television. No borders, no censors, available in every home. Al Jazeera broke with traditions and taboos. Many said that Al Jazeera has untied the knot in the Arab tongue. The regimes of the region were not pleased. It rained criticism, much of it from the West. The private television of Osama bin Laden, wrote the New York Times. Habitual liars, complained U.S. Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld. On the other hand, Arab media labeled Al Jazeera a U.S. conspiracy or product of the Zionists. And for Gaddafi, it was simply a dog network. Al Jazeera has always lived from controversy. It was part of its credibility. After 9/11, however, the most serious criticism came. reporting on the Afghanistan war. They aired the tapes of Osama bin Laden, traveled to Iraq with the insurgents, and broadcasted pictures and information that no one else had. Osama bin Laden was hiding in Afghanistan. Only one journalist spoke to him after the attack on the United States, Al Jazeera correspondent in Kabul, Taizir Alouni. He met the terrorist in the mountains and filmed an interview. Later in Spain, he would be convicted of helping finance Al-Qaeda and condemned to 7 years in prison. Another in the eye of this storm was Al Jazeera cameraman Sami Al-Haj, apprehended by U.S. forces in Pakistan and interred as an enemy combatant in Guantanamo. Al Jazeera campaigned for his release, but he was to sit for 6 years without official charges or a trial. In May 2008, he is released. After my return to Al Jazeera, I had the feeling that I was back again with my family. All my colleagues celebrated my return with warm feelings. It helped me find closure with the terrible experience I had there for 6 years. مقابلة دافئة أنستني مرارة السنوات التي قضيتها خلف الغضبان. Today, Sami Al-Haj sits in the newsroom at Al Jazeera. He runs the so-called Human Rights Desk and is assigned to help endangered journalists around the world. The Middle East region desperately needs to know more about human rights. Most citizens in this region know very, very little about human rights at all. In our work, we see how little people really know. But if they don't know their rights, how can they begin to defend them? Here at Al Jazeera, we've decided to dedicate ourselves to informing viewers about their rights. يدرك المشاهد ويتعلم حقوقه حتى يستطيع الدفاع عنها. The foyer at Al Jazeera is not your usual reception area. Visitors here are confronted with a museum, an exhibit in the honor of Al Jazeera staff who were interred, tortured, or killed. When Sami Al-Haj arrives at work, he sometimes stops here to view his letters or the white clothing he wore when released from Guantanamo. January 2011, the Arab uprising is spreading from Tunisia to Egypt, and the situation is growing more dangerous for the Mubarak regime and for the journalists from Al Jazeera. Egypt has a powerful secret police, and they have a nasty reputation for torture. Protests are concentrated in Tahrir Square in Cairo. They begin peacefully, but soon they build into a dangerous confrontation with the state. The crowds grow. Their protests are louder, their demands bolder. While President Mubarak tries to maintain diplomatic dignity, militias react viciously on the streets. Mounted police on horses and camels storm through the crowds with machetes. Shots are fired. People die. But the demonstrators do not withdraw.
Some people thought we were part of what's happening. Actually, we were not. We were rather the mirror through which Arab people saw themselves and feel that they were on the right track.
For police and military, the media are irritating. In an effort at censorship, they remove Al Jazeera from the Egyptian satellite Nilesat and shut down the internet. Yet events on Tahrir Square are still being televised, not just by Al Jazeera. TV crews from CNN, BBC, and Reuters have also taken up position on the roofs. Army and police do not dare attack the protesters, not live on television. On January 27th, armed soldiers order the TV crews to shut down operations. In the satellite office of Al Jazeera, people begin to worry.
The moment that all the media went out of the hotels around the Tahrir Square and the picture just disappeared for around maybe more than 1 hour, we were wondering here at the newsroom, oh God, what's happening there in Tahrir Square right now? Because nobody knows what is happening there. Maybe the regimes or the troops or the police will enter and will do some massacres or something like that.
The people who are demonstrating in Egypt, they called us and they asked us, please, please don't take off the camera, because if you take off the camera, switch off the camera, they will kill us.
The cameras at Tahrir Square have been turned off. 10,000s of protesters fear for their lives. Quietly, Ali Al-Kabi is trying to set up a signal between the laptop of his man on the ground and a satellite.
Maybe the regimes or the troops or the police will enter and will do some massacres or something like that. Looks like what happened the nights before. Then I was communicating with my colleague, his name Mohammed, Engineer Mohammed. He said that I succeed, I'm now in the middle of the people and I'm trying to give you a signal from there.
The laptop connects with the satellite and Al Jazeera can resume broadcasting live from the crowd. The military does not open fire. Cameramen and protesters are protecting each other.
They were trying actually to find where is this picture coming from, but they didn't succeed because they weren't able to enter inside the Tahrir Square. If you remember that days, the people or the youth, they just closed all the entrances. It was around maybe 12 entrances, 9 main and the other extra three entrances. They blocked all that. They make looks like, you know, a human shade to prevent all the troops or the police from entering inside the square. And that was, you know, giving like a security or a safety for our cameraman to stay there. And the people there, they were, you know, they told him that keep doing it and we will protect you.
President Hosni Mubarak understands the seriousness of the situation. He tries to reshuffle his government, even announces his pending resignation, but it is too late. The largest country in the Arab world has fallen, a powerful country and a strategic one, with a border to Gaza, with control over the Suez Canal, and most importantly, with a peace treaty with Israel.
It was really emotional, you know, when we saw millions going to the street, shouting for freedom. And we feel actually that the Arab world is going to change. It's going to change for the better, for freedom, for democracy, for a better understanding what's going around.
When Mubarak announced he is leaving presidency in Egypt, there was really the emotion that was common all over the Arab world. At Al Jazeera, we felt it was it came as a surprise, and we were very euphoric about it.
When Arab journalists come together in these turbulent times, like here at the Arab Media Forum in Dubai, there's only one subject, the Arab uprising and the role of Al Jazeera.
If you are talking television, when you look to Al Jazeera, they don't have many advertising. They don't have. They just care about the audience. They care about to give you the true story. They care about to give you really what happened.
Al Jazeera transformed the landscape of Arab media, but there are competitors now. Other countries have established alternative news outlets, such as Al Arabiya in Dubai.
As an Arab citizen, I say that Al Jazeera is doing the best, is good, but as a reporter, as a journalist, I think that there is something that should be adjusted in Al Jazeera programs and news, that the coverage is good, but there is a trying to lead the audiences to some results. As in Egyptian revolution, we saw that some people come in Al Jazeera and they are trying to guide the people what to do.
Al Jazeera is undisputed market leader as a television station, but hotly disputed as a news source. There is much debate about the Arab uprising and the role of a free press. While Al Jazeera expresses pride in their influence on events, other journalists criticize it as spin.
Some of the media, like Al Jazeera, sometimes going with the one angle, not to get another angle. It's become confusing in the covering the media, and there is a lot of the information to give that for Al Jazeera or something. So we find in some status, you can find Al Jazeera, it's in one angle, look, one angle. And trying to put, and the other angle is small area for that, in the opinion.
It's not only about Al Jazeera or Al Arabiya or whatever. In my opinion, it starts by Facebook and Twitter. The new media worked more than the Arabic television. Arabic television was good in the, or it made something different in the revolution.
Storyboards and sketches, animation and artwork. This is the shop for Al Jazeera high-end graphic design. In the promotion department, editors and artists are constantly rebranding their network. Their symbols are dramatic. Their soundtracks, loud. For Western audiences, they seem better suited for computer games than for news programming. But in the Arab world, this is a popular style, especially in times such as these. Dramatic times demand dramatic symbolism. Al Jazeera is not a commercial broadcaster. The bottom line shows no profits. But for the royal family in Qatar, Al Jazeera is high on prestige, and the network is expanding rapidly. Its English language channel launched in November 2006 and already has a strong global following. They have a separate editorial team, a different broadcast format, and surprisingly little similarity with the main Arabic channel. In addition to the Arab and English language news, Al Jazeera maintains a documentary channel, live channel, a children's channel, and 18 sports channels. In the hallways of the station hang photos of staff members. At the entrance, this reporter, Dorothy Parvaz. She was kidnapped in Syria and taken to prison in Iran. During the shoot for this film, she was released. Al Jazeera stands by its people. Those who have lost their lives on duty are not forgotten. Here, Atwar Bayat, kidnapped and executed while filming in Iraq. Tarek Ayoud, killed during a bombing attack on Baghdad. And cameraman Rashid Vali, shot while filming a street battle. Outside, the Freedom Wall is a monument to reporters around the globe. Over 620 names of journalists killed at work. A memorial for a dangerous calling, a sacrifice by journalists seeking the truth.
Al Jazeera people, they have the feeling or the spirit that they should do their duty at the best, at the maximum, and they feel that the people, whether in Libya or in Egypt or in any other place, that the people need very much another the news agencies or the news TVs to carry out their messages to the rest world. So when they feel that the people relying on them, they will even spend their lives.
When authoritarian regimes realize they are fighting for survival, their brutality knows no bounds. Dangers for journalists rise severely. At the Al Jazeera satellite desk, Ali Al-Kabi knows this all too well. A friend from Qatar is in the war zone in Libya. Cameraman Al-Jaber, the home office, is worried. The people of Qatar have little experience with danger. Their country is secure, their finances are stable, as the wealthiest population in the world. The souk in the city is a modern bazaar. The young stroll leisurely in groups along the cobblestone alleyways, drinking tea in the cafes and smoking their shishas. Their elders were raised in a different world, a world of huts and goat herds, pearl divers and poverty. A little confused, they watch the younger generation pursue modern lifestyles, radically different, yet strongly rooted in tribal culture. The Qataris are a religious people, their faith an enlightened Islam. Their TV network is also religious. Often TV experts advise on religious issues or discuss them in round tables. A former editor-in-chief once described Al Jazeera as the minaret of the Arab media.
Everyone here has faith, and he knows that, and they like their job, their career. They know that Jazeera is not as another television in the Arab world, even in the world.
To hell with Qatar, Gaddafi screams on television in February. To hell with the network of dogs, Al Jazeera. Benghazi has become a dangerous place for Al Jazeera. There have been threats against the crew, threats against cameraman Al-Jaber.
We were in communicating with them always, all the time, and always asking them, come on, we are relying on you to bring us the pictures, the news, but this is not important than your lives. Your lives, it's the most important for us. And Ali Jaber, I can say that he was always telling me, Ali, don't worry about this. The atmosphere here in Benghazi, it's safe, and I could die anywhere.
Officially, Ali Al-Kabi is responsible for technical transmissions, but day for day, he is also in personal contact with the correspondents, those in harm's way. This is part of his job too, taking care of his people.
It was a very, very shocking news for us here. When I received the call, I was outside actually. I received the call, my colleagues, they told me, Ali, if you are driving, just park on the side. I told, no, let me know what's happening.
Ali Al-Kabi is in shock. A dear friend has been shot and killed in Benghazi. He was supposed to be on office duty, but he had gone out with the correspondent.
Ali Jaber dead. Actually, I didn't believe that because, you know, I thought something wrong happened or just a misunderstanding. Because I know Ali Jaber, he's staying at the office.
It was an ambush. With a fake phone call, Gaddafi's secret police lured the Al Jazeera crew into a suburb. Sharpshooters were waiting. Sitting in the back seat, cameraman Al-Jaber didn't have a chance.
And when suddenly you have a news that one of your team just lost, sometimes you're just asking yourself why. Then you back again and say, this is the duty. And we know on this field we might return safe or just disappear.
Maybe Ali worked with most of our colleagues here in the newsroom when they have assignment outside in other countries. They traveled together. He worked not as cameraman, just like cameraman. He was a brother for all of us.
Oh God, we're very, very big sorry. Big. We feel too much sorry about that. But we know that every time the coast of this kind of profession, and you know that you're professional, and you know that it's very big sometimes. Sometimes you sacrifice your life.
April 2011. New uprisings in Syria and Libya present new challenges for Al Jazeera. They have no correspondents here, no camera crews, no equipment on the scene. Reliable information is hard to come by and dangerous. In their conferences, editors discuss sources. Like the rest of the world, the network is now dependent on new media. Technology has once again changed the rules of the game. Satellite broadcasters no longer have a monopoly on uncensored global news. New players have arrived on the field. They're called Facebook and YouTube, Skype and Twitter. They are fast, global, and accessible to all.
This is our job, and we are trying to do our best to get information about what's happening in these countries, especially like Syria and Libya. We have no correspondents, we have no bureaus, we have no offices, we have no facilities. So you have to depend on what's happening and your sources.
Al Jazeera is constantly under criticism. In 2001, Fatah shuts down its offices in the West Bank. August 2002, the King of Jordan closes the Amman Bureau. In November, the Emir closes the Al Jazeera Bureau in Kuwait City. In August 2004, Iraq expels the correspondent. And in Tehran and Tunisia, Al Jazeera is never accredited. The exclusion of correspondents hardly means an end to coverage for Al Jazeera. New media offer new sources. Citizen journalists with cell phone interviews and smartphone photos. No censor in the world can stop such a flood of information. For the trade of the television journalist, however, it is a game changer.
We could make good by using the citizen journalist, first of all, and sometimes, people from our editors or producers were traveling and doing some work in the absence of authorities in the middle of the revolution in Egypt. We have been able to send people to report from there, apart from our office which was closed. So, it did a lot of damage to our normal kind of operation, but always there was a way out of it.
New media creates new professions. Suddenly, citizen journalists have become key sources for mainstream news outlets. Their videos on YouTube, their posts on Facebook and Twitter offer insights and information not available elsewhere. But there are pitfalls.
Everyone is using Facebook. Governments are using Facebook. Security apparatuses in these governments are using Facebook extensively, and activists are using Facebook. So you cannot just simply take out the information and put it on the air, otherwise you will be facing a lot of embarrassing situations.
Fakes in Facebook are a serious problem for program director Arif Ijawi. The network's credibility depends on the reliability of its sources. An entire department is monitoring new media, verifying content as best they can.
It's a difficult thing to establish that this news is correct. It's a lot of collecting of items, a lot of contacts, phoning everybody to check, double check that it is correct news. And we have done it nicely. We have got it first time correct in, I would say, 99% of the time.
There are other concerns, like the safety of the people who act as their sources. Citizen journalists, often inexperienced in crises, may become targets for disinformation. Or worse, they may be in mortal danger. What can the network do to protect them?
Is there a dangerous or danger on your life or your free? Don't do the interview. But sometimes you find them ready to do this. Not for Al Jazeera, but sometimes for his country.
You are the dog from Al Jazeera, a soldier screams. You reported for Al Jazeera, and the beating begins. Terrified, hands tied, the prisoners sit helplessly in the back of a pickup. Again and again, they are beaten by the rifle butts of the Libyan soldiers. Again and again, they are told to say they love Gaddafi and hate Al Jazeera. This video was filmed by a soldier who deserted, and the fate of the prisoners is not known.
You sometimes, as a human being, you feel that you are responsible on about his safety or his life or his freedom.
How does that feel?
Sorry, I can't. I feel sorry.
Veiled women, laughing children, luxury limousines. It's National Day in Qatar, and the streets of the capital are a sea of violet flags. A proud nation, wealthiest in the world, host for the 2022 World Cup, stockholder in dozens of Fortune 500 companies. Qatar has survived by compromise, a careful negotiator between nations, a strategy of opinion and opposing opinion, the strategy of Al Jazeera. April 2011, protests and casualties in Syria. At first, reporting is cautious. Qatar maintains friendly relations with Syria. Not until later, when Qatar began distancing itself diplomatically, does Al Jazeera grow critical. The same in Bahrain, February 2011. The Sunni rulers of Bahrain are close allies of Qatar. Both are members of the Defense Alliance Gulf Cooperation Council, GCC. Both fear the Shiite groups demonstrating on the streets and supported by the mullahs in Iran. The Saudis dispatch soldiers. The caution of the editors at Al Jazeera is very conspicuous.
Every channel has policies, and every channel has to deal with these policies. Now, Bahrain is a very dangerous spot for all the Arabs, especially in the Gulf. So everybody has to be very careful in there.
The archives of Al Jazeera hold thousands of tapes, the broadcasts of 15 years of media history, opinion and opposing opinion, politics and provocations.
Al Jazeera became the address of the revolutions. And if you remember, the protesters or demonstrators in the Al-Tahrir Square put Al Jazeera screen in the square and called it at the revolution channel.
There is a big benefit of these revolutions. I think even in Europe, in the world, they will change their strategy, the way they are dealing with the Arab world, because it's not as before. Before it was corrupted, no democracy, and there is no freedom.
10, 9, 8, 7,
the true test for Al Jazeera
5,
lies
4,
in the future.
3, 2, 1.
In the months and years that will come after the uprisings, free journalism, reporting on free governments, for it will always be easier to overthrow a corrupt regime than to build a stable democracy. That will be difficult for the citizens building their new nations, and difficult for the press that reports on it.